With advancements in the healthcare space, continuous medical education, or CME, has become vital for not just maintaining but improving the quality of India's healthcare system. The Integrated Health and Wellbeing Council organized the inaugural edition of the CME Excellence Summit and Awards in New Delhi to emphasize the importance of CME for the medical fraternity. The initiative brought together policymakers, medical practitioners, pharma and medical organizations to discuss and deliberate upon the role of CME in ensuring streamlined supply of a quality healthcare workforce and to recognize the exceptional work done by medical practitioners. The summit began with a lamp lighting ceremony. Soon after, keynote addresses by distinguished speakers from various industry verticals, along with the Minister of State for Health and Family Welfare, Ashwini Kumar Chaubey, gracing the occasion as the chief guest, established the need of CME for quality healthcare delivery.
Let me first, introduce the theme, which is evolving role of hospitals and diagnostics industry in CME. Where is India headed? So I'm going to now request our panelists to kindly grace the stage. But first, let me invite our chair, Dr. Hema Diwaker, CEO, artist. Let's welcome the lady with a big round of applause. Welcome, ma'am. May I now invite Shri P Raghavendra Rao, Secretary, Department of Chemicals and Petrochemicals, Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, Government of India. I've been told he's going to be joining us. He's on his way. So let me invite Dr. Kiran Godse, President-elect IADVL. A big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, for Dr. Kiran Godse. I'd like to invite Dr. Mangesh Tiwaskar, Secretary, API. Can we please request Dr. Mangesh Tiwaskar to kindly grace the dais? May I invite Ms. Savitha Kuttan, CEO, Omnicuris. There she is. Warm welcome, ma'am. So, ladies and gentlemen, we will be graced very shortly by Dr. Mangesh Tiwaskar and Shri P. Raghavendra Rao. In the meantime, I'm going to hand over the conversation to our chair so that she can set the context, ma'am.
Namaskar. Once again, on behalf of IHW Council and Omnicuris, we invite you to join the post-tea session on the deliberations that the 30-minute 50% of the panelists are going to place before you. It's all about how we want to move away the CMEs and the workshops from the traditional method to the technology-based deliberations. Well, if we have to look back and ask ourselves, 20 years from now, we may all be saying, in the year 2019, on August 8th, people actually met face-to-face, because the era may change as much as everything happening on the cloud. I have been noticing how hard it is to let go of the habits and the behavior that we have developed over the years. For example, Savitha Kuttan, the CEO and founder, go digital, she says, but holding a piece of paper. Aishwarya, also referring to the paper. Every other moderator. So it is, you know, in keeping with the trends that we have to determine to let go. You know, we cannot be clinging on to our old accustomed behavior, and it is very hard to change. As Mahatma Gandhi said, be the change you want to see. And if I ask everybody, do you want to see the change? And all of you may say, yes, we want to see the change. Who wants to change? Maybe, you know, the answer may not be so very well forthcoming. So we will take you with our esteemed panelists through their journey. As Arul Raj mentioned, the technology transfer is for knowledge, that is the theoretical knowledge and the wisdom that has to go with it, and the skills transfer. So the storytelling is one of the best ways to transfer the knowledge base with wisdom. What have these eminent experts gone through in their journey from shifting from the traditional CME and workshop methodology. Kiran Godse, the president-elect of IADVL. What is it all about? Okay, Mr. Google. Indian Association of Dermatologists, Venerologists, and Leprologists. Yes? Yeah. So that is Kiran Godse for you in the position of a president-elect. So both personal and organizational. Dr. Kiran, we want you to take us through the journey of how you got into the space of transforming the tradition into digital modality, and in your own merit, how you're going to see it happen in your own organization.
Yeah, well, good evening to all. Let me tell you that I am Kiran Godse, professor of dermatology from D.V. Patil Hospital, and I am president-elect of the association. You will be surprised to know that we are 11,000 strong dermatologists all over India, and we have got huge corporate office in New Delhi with good amount of turnover of almost 20 crores. So we have got huge business which we do every day on academic front, social front, as well as for the general social welfare also. Well, technology is the thing. Well, if you know that a dermatologist, a skin specialist, I just happened to meet three doctors, out of which two told me, the fungus is growing now. You know, they said, what you do? And to tell you the first story, the first hit, which all thanks to Omnicuris, that we done a fungal CME. We say fungal pe dangal. What it means is there is a dangal going on in fungus, which is not getting treated fast. So we not wanted to share our knowledge, but we couldn't share. We could share to 50 people, 100 people. But with online platform, we could reach 6,000, I repeat, 6,000 doctors, dermatologists all over out of 11,000. Our Omnicuris platform has been able to tell those people, okay, look, this is the right way to treat this fungus, which would not have never achieved even if you had done a huge conference. So thanks to the digital platform that we have been able to realize what we wanted to going to every and each dermatologist and each and every family physician to understand why this fungus is growing and how best to treat it. Yeah. So that is what has changed.
Yeah. Thank you, Kiran. And he says from a handful to 6,000. And we say India is 1.25 billion. How do we reach all of them? Here we have with us one of our very distinguished panelists, Raghavendra Rao, who has just arrived. And he is from the ministry. He's the secretary to petroleum and chemical from the Ministry of Petroleum and Fertilizers. Much awaited arrival of Shri Raghavendra Rao, because as individuals, as organizations, we can do only this far and this much, but involving the government is absolutely inevitable for us to reach to scale that we envisage that we should move ahead. So thank you, Kiran, for that lovely, determined personal journey. We will go next to Savitha. Meanwhile, I'll allow Sir to just assimilate his thoughts on this panel on moving away from traditional CMEs and workshops to the digital technology. So to place on records, the 360-degree turn, we run an organization called The Artist, which is also receiving the award today, Asian Research and Training Institute for Skill Transfer. So Artist also gives away awards called the Reality Awards, those who turn their dreams into reality. Savitha Kuttan received the award from Artist 3 years ago because she's not only turned her dreams into reality, but us as well. So congratulations yet again, Savitha, for putting us all together on site and on digital platforms through the years. And we witnessed the sincerity, honesty, commitment, and excellence in execution of everything that happens on the Omnicuris platform. And I know when you started, there may not have been many takers for this. So we want you to take us through your journey on how you made this happen.
Thank you for those kind words, Dr. Hema. And I must say that when we started off our journey, she was one of the visionary who actually came in and said, like how she started off saying today, that sitting 10 years from now, we will look back and say, on August 8th, we actually met face-to-face, and people will go, oh, you all actually met face-to-face. while, you know, she's much more advanced than any of us, and she had that vision and she was an immense support. So thank you very much, ma'am, for those support that you gave us. And to also address a very important point that she said, while we are talking about technology, and still all of us have paper because of the way we are habituated. So I wanted to address one of that point, that we at Omnicuris, we have always believed that technology is always going to complement the physical activities and the physical conferences and workshops which will happen and will continue to happen, and it will never be 100% replacement of the physical workshops and conferences. And all our motto and our philosophy of Omnicuris has always been like that. I'll give you a quick context of when we started. We have always, as I said, we have always thought that technology should only be an enabler and not a solution in itself. And traditionally, various medical associations in our country has already been doing a phenomenal job in the space of CMEs and workshops. And in India, there is no dearth of medical content per se. There are all of you sitting here, experts, you would have all contributed immensely in your journey as doctors to the field of academics. What was missing is the use of technology to multiply the reach of good work that these academic bodies were already doing. And what we did at Omnicuris, we only enabled the change. We combined the rich medical expertise of the various medical associations and medical institutes, and we combined it with the cutting-edge technology, which is what we knew, and that is how Omnicuris was born. And we used it as a solution to complement and augment the impact of continuous medical education by partnering with over 35 different bodies. We partnered with all the medical associations, starting from the IME to the API to the FOCSI to IOA, ISG, and the list goes on. We partnered with premium medical institutes. Thanks to all of those institutes for placing trust on us, starting from AIIMS New Delhi to Tata Memorial Center to Jayadeva, MUHS, and again the list goes on. We have been engaged by over 8 state governments across the country for various capacity building initiatives. And thus, jointly, we have been able to reach over 1 lakh doctors in the country in a very short span of time by leveraging technology only as an enabler and as a collaboration tool, but not as something that would replace the traditionally happening CMEs and conferences. Thank you, Dr. Hema.
Thank you, Savitha. It is a good message that there always needs to be a blend, because everything that's new necessarily is not everything that you ought to capture and move ahead. Rooted in traditions, as we say, there are certain things which come as challenges with the technology itself, though we appreciate the reach and the scale that it can reach with the quality. So, I was thinking, how should I position Shri Raghavendra Rao in this panel? Then, you know, again, YouTube, I said, what's he saying about? What's he talking? What's going on in his mind? And there was one seminar where he spoke about plastics and how he needs to convey to the people the advocacy about the environmental toxins, the fertilizers, the chemicals, the petroleum, etc., etc. So we as doctors need to break our silos. It is not only the technical knowledge about the health, but there are n number of environmental factors, inclusive of air pollution, etc., which will influence the epidemiology of the disease processes, for example. So, sir, my question to you is, we need the government who says go digital, so advocacy will be, you know, very empowering to the citizens themselves. And what is your thought process about how you, as a collaborating partner to the excellence in CMEs, can help us move forward this agenda?
Yeah, thank you. Good evening, friends. Initially, when I was invited here, I was just wondering, as an administrator, what I can talk to the doctors. What are the things that would be of interest to you? I was just wondering. You see, till 2 months back, for about 2 months and odd, I was also holding the charge as Secretary Pharma. So I gained some kind of knowledge and some interaction with the doctors and medical profession. So before I come to the point you have raised, let me talk very generally, which perhaps would be of interest to you, from the government perspective. You see, the Honorable Prime Minister took a meeting of all the secretaries. Perhaps if I remember the date correctly, I think it was on 10th of June. He asked all of us to prepare a roadmap as to where each department or each sector would like to see itself by 2024-25. So when he gave these directions to us, we started thinking, we started discussing, debating. Certain interesting things were brought to my notice. Perhaps all of you are aware that India has certain inherent advantages now. We are quite strong in generic medicines. In fact, many of you must be knowing, somebody gave me the statistics, that every third pill in the US is made in India. I'm sure it must be correct. Somebody said out of four pills, one comes from India in UK. And somebody said 60% of the vaccines are produced in India. Another statistic was that between 40 to 60% of all the medicines procured by WHO and all international organizations are procured from India. So, but there are certain things on the which are of concern. We lack critical APIs. We import a lot of APIs. Of course, we are strong on formulations, but on critical APIs, we are quite weak. We have a long way to go. Similarly, medical devices. We significantly import the medical devices. So as an administrator, we started debating what we need to do to remedy the situation. If you have done very well on formulations, how can we do it for bulk drugs? How can we improve the situation as far as medical devices are concerned? How do we ensure affordability, accessibility, and availability of medicines to the masses? What can we do? How do we ensure that innovation is given encouragement, support? How do we ensure more number of patents come out in the medical field, in the pharma field? How do we do that? We started debating, discussing. For your information, the pharma sector is trade surplus. We get about $11 billion as trade surplus in this sector. It's a good thing. There's only very few sectors where we are in a trade surplus. The overall strength of the sector is about around $38 billion now. So when we started preparing the vision document, we also wanted a dashboard how the sector is improving over a period of time. Now I'm talking on pharma. I'll slightly later talk about the overall chemical sector. So when we started analyzing it, we said, let us look at the points of strength. What are the opportunities that are available? What are the challenges the sector is facing? Okay, what can be done? What is the roadmap for us? Then, for example, how do we ensure that more and more medical devices are produced in the country? name it CT scan, or you name any kind of medical device, how do we do that? We are now formulating a policy so as to attract the best technologies that are available in the world, attracting them to come and invest in India, start producing them in India. So now we are formulating a scheme whereby we say that any medical device industry that wants to establish itself in India, we give a lot of support, both in terms of common infrastructure, testing facilities, standardization, skilling support, and so on and so forth. Similarly, what can be done for bulk drugs? Same kind of schemes we are now coming up. How do we support the SMEs, small-scale sector? We are now formulating a scheme for interest subvention so that the small-scale industry is able to establish itself. How do we ensure adequate skill development in the sector? We have the NIPERS. I don't know how many of you are aware of this. We have 7 NIPERS, National Institutes for Pharma Education and Research. We have all over the country. They do a lot of research in coming up with various formulations, various pharma products. How do we ensure that the R&D facilities in these NIPERS get strengthened, gets improved? How do we ensure that the academic content of these NIPERS syllabus significantly improves and matches with the best in the world?
So I just want to interrupt you here to just share with you that recently I returned from Israel on a conference on women's health, on innovations and inventions. I believe that the Indian government and the Israeli authorities for innovations want to collaborate on point of care equipment so that the skill building becomes rather very, very easy, because, you know, any healthcare provider can use this device, and again the technology can transmit it through the devices to the experts for the further management. So what's your thought process on how much could we move ahead supporting as technical people on issues like these?
I think you're bang on the point. It is very important that we not only invite and attract investments in the pharma and medical device sector, but also simultaneously focus on skilling of the people, so that the people who are going to be employed there, they take full benefit of it, and then the country also benefits. We must not only be the net importer of medical devices. About 80%, in fact 90% of the medical devices are being imported into the country. Various reasons are there. So we need to address, get into the details because of the shortage of time. I'll not get into the 2 minute details, but the fact is that we need to strengthen ourselves in the medical devices sector. There's one factor which I would like to share with you. Doctors, you're all the most important section of the society, which I personally feel. You see, pricing of the drugs and medical devices is a very important thing. It's a very contentious thing. Particularly, let me start with stents. You have two types of stent: bare metal stents and drug-eluting stents. We fix the prices of stents and we fix the ceiling price of kneecaps. They're hue and cry. They're hue and cry. Every day, your delegations used to come and say, what is this? You're killing innovation. How do we come up with new products? So now we are working on a principle of trade margin rationalization. We said, okay, If your cost of production is pretty high, let us not get into profiteering. Normal profits are okay for us. But if you get into profiteering and make undue killing out of the whole thing, it is not acceptable. I was told that the trade margin is about 400%, 500%, sometimes 1,000%. This is just not acceptable. Bulk of the population are either middle class or below the middle class. So maybe the super rich can afford.
So I want to come in again to tell you how technology, in your mind, can help us create absolute transparency in the kind of devices and the pricing, like how we see in the advertisement of Policy Bazaar. You can compare, you know, whatever is happening. So would that not be a good way to move ahead and give the choice to the consumer what they would want to do?
Certainly, certainly. If somebody can afford, if I'm the Reliance chairman, if I want a very high technology thing, I can afford. But what about the masses? 70%, 80% of the masses cannot afford. When stents, if I remember, when my father had a stent, maybe early 90s, we had to pay about 1.5 lakhs. Now the stent cost is 19,000, 20,000, 22,000, 23,000. It is in that range. So it is, you see, the number of stents that have been used, are being used in the country, has significantly gone up after we went in for price regulation. So
one more thing, sir. When you're saying that so much of support you are ready to, you know, give our, you know, community, professional community, how reassuring can you be to us with respect to government endorsing, provided the professional organizations give a quality-based skilling as well as the knowledge transfer through technology? That is essentially the topic of the panel. The endorsements and the encouragement for moving this ahead, just in order to reach every individual who may not have had the benefit of traveling right across, as we have heard through this afternoon, difficulty in access, difficulty in actually getting to the best of the speakers, etc., etc. So what would be the outlook of the government to a professional body and an organization? There were many leaders from the councils here as well who in their own states are debating of how far they have gone, how much more can they do. The guarantee of the same face sitting at the chair and actually taking the course, etc. What is the thought process of the government on these lines? Would it be difficult, easy? How fast track can we move ahead on this process? Because that will be crucial for us.
Certainly. You see, we have to balance the interests of... There are several players in the entire value chain. You have to balance the interests. You have the producers, you have the distributors at various levels and all that. So we want the best in the world. Whatever is the best, it should be available. But at the same time, it should be affordable. So maybe what is affordable to me may not be affordable to somebody who is a lower middle class. Maybe the affordability factor for a rich person is different. So maybe they can afford certain things. So what we are now doing is, for the information of the House, the price control, we have divided into three broad areas. One is essential medicines, then otherwise other medicines, then we have the medical devices. What we are controlling now is only about 18% of the medicine market, the pricing through pricing. But we are also saying this drug price control order, which we have issued, what we are saying is those people who are coming with innovative products or who have a patent, who come up with latest technologies, for 5 years, we'll keep you out of this price control. You come up with a new product, you come up with a new thing, we'll encourage innovation. Okay, but then we'll keep you out of the price control for some time. Mm-hmm. But after that, you must ensure that you come under price control. The common man should be able to afford the technology and take the full benefit of that.
Okay, so here is the future. Some innovative point of care devices where the skill transfer can very easily be done through the technology because it doesn't require much skill. Equipment does it all, and it's a beautiful thing to reach through the frontline healthcare providers and many in the interiors of the country. I swing back to Dr. Kiran. As of now, from your organization, how confident you are that the skills that you have imparted in just showing them some pictures of some skin lesions and teaching them something, and how are you sure that it has had the right impact for decongesting decongesting the tertiary care? You know, at the primary level, how much can you do
in skin care
through technology?
That is a thing, you know. A skin specialist is the only specialty. When I see, I diagnose. My brain doesn't know, I can't diagnose. Mm-hmm. So there where artificial intelligence comes, and there are apps being developed by AIIMS, even by our DY Patil Hospital, mm-hmm. where the artificial intelligence get more than 10 lakhs images, and then just a photograph and you can diagnose and you can get the treatment. So AI-based, app-based training to the doctors and for the benefit of general population, this could be feature because skin is totally reliable on the how many images I have seen, something like radiology.
Yes.
Same education, what we have done is our D.Y. Patil book for postgraduate has come in app-based thing. So app-based learning, teaching, training is a future possibility which I feel good for doctors.
Excellent. I want to just take a quick rapid feedback from Savitha. All of us do your Omnicuris online courses and there's a score sheet and you know you answer. What is the percentage of those who actually complete the course and who actually get moving with competency and confidence to handle? What is your take on that? Has there been any background analysis from Omnicuris?
Yes, so our analysis has been, Dr. Hema, that we actually have in our platform over lakh doctors who are accessing. Out of the over lakh doctors, we noticed that only 30% of those doctors are actually doing it for the sake of credits. Now, what it means is that we say that you get credit points because that's what the councils told us, only if you finish the four-hour module on probably a topic, say, acute coronary syndrome. Now, the doctors who are accessing our platform, they say that we have credits because we go to conferences, but why we need this point, you know, this finger, an application on our fingertips is to go back and refer to it when we need it because that is more convenient for us. We want to look at the topics that we want to see, and education and patient care, they see not as different, two different things. They actually relate that the questions that they get from patient care makes a context for them to learn. So that is what we have observed, that it is not for credit points, it is not for just finishing or their certification. They are actually coming for learning. They are actually coming for giving better quality care to their patients, and they give us feedback, and we have 100% feedback compliance. Yeah. The completion rate, though, is about
55%. Just give me some examples of those feedbacks. What do people say about Omnicuris after they've taken the course?
We gave the first feedback. What she says is right. Somebody, doctor wants to know, he wants to learn, he will go and learn. Listen. So fungal is a being now hot topic. So we had a huge thing. So many people went because everybody wants to know what's going on, why it's not treating. So patients, doctors who wants to know something, they're going to do online and learn it.
So our president Nandita is here, and Foxy was the one who first instituted the online courses on thyroid diseases, on simple things like anemia, where we had 7,800 OBGYNs booking into the course, which was very, very surprising. Diabetes, of course, is the hot course, which is, you know, much in demand, and the PCOS as well. Similarly, on the Echo platform, which is a two-way dialogue, that is what we use for skilling. We have to make the teams who come on the digital platform actually demonstrate to us the emergency care, how they do it, and we do demonstrate the wrong method and ask them to point out what was wrong. So there are many innovative ways in which the skill can be transferred, and it can certainly happen through the digital platform. Last rapid round of questions. We are all going gaga over the digital world and we can do this and that. What are some of the real challenges that you would see here? And we will wrap up with that, promising and pledging that we shall overcome those challenges and move ahead.
Yeah, exactly. Just three words. Technology should go to right people, right person, not to quacks. It should not be misused or abused because it's free, online, available. And it should be go to right hands with accreditation.
Savitha.
Yes, so as Dr. Kiran said, technology going to the right hands is definitely a good point. And that's actually the role of technology, that you can set access controls to make sure that the right person gets it. And one of the challenges that we have also seen is that when it goes to tier 3 and beyond, and that is where it needed the most, the access and the availability of 3G or 4G starts going down, but it's improving now than what we have seen 3 years ago. But that is one real practical challenge. We, within Omnicuris, have worked out on various bandwidth optimizations so that the quality goes down when the bandwidth goes lower and still the video plays. But still, we wanted this technology to reach to the remotest of the places, and access to a high quality and high speed internet connection becomes a very big important.
So what's the next big idea with Omnicuris? Where do you want to go from here?
So we are constantly looking at expanding our content, tying up with more institutes, tying up with more organizations, which is connecting conferences. We have 1 lakh doctors today. We are looking at expanding to about 2.5 lakh doctors by end of next year.
So not in the context of medical CMEs, perhaps in your own capacity as the Secretary for Petroleum and Chemicals, is there any final message that you want to give us through digital technology? How can we break the silos and everybody can achieve something out of it?
Yeah, you see, I will not limit myself to digital technology. You see, my view would for the future, my vision for the future is that the masses should be able to access the best technology products, best technology devices, which are affordable, accessible, and available to the masses. How do we do that? That is the ultimate aim, and in that direction we should move. We are working on that.
Thank you very much. We bring this panel to a close with some excellent ideas for the future. So next time we meet on the cloud, we will share more of this. Thank you, Dr. Kiran, Savitha, and Shri Raghavendra Rao, sir. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for your kind attention.
Let's have a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Madam Chair and eminent panelists. I request you to please stay with us. I invite Mr. Gupta, Director, IHW Council, to join us on stage. We'll be honored with your applause, Shri P Raghavendra Rao. Thank you very much, sir. Dr. Kiran Godse, President-elect, IADDL. Big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. For Dr. Godse, thank you so much, sir. And of course, now to our chair and moderator, Dr. Hema Diwaker, CEO, artist, past president of Oxy and Sego. A big round of applause for Dr. Hema Diwaker. A little better on the applause. A big round of applause.